Surprised to learn that at this moment, some of our members of Parliament and the House of Commons are not merely alive and well, but are discussing, yes, the subject of devolution. You might have thought that after the government's crushing defeat on Tuesday, that matter was now dead. Not so. It's one of the ironies of the government's failure to win the vote on the motion to guillotine discussion of the Scotland and Wales Bill, as it's called, that the debate on it continues tonight as if nothing whatsoever has happened. In reality, of course, a great deal has happened. The government's been humiliated, and the question of its very survival is now a matter for serious debate. Perhaps ministers should have taken a closer note of our programme a fortnight ago, in which we predicted a defeat for the government by a margin of at least 22 votes. Or perhaps they knew too well what might happen, but for lack of a better alternative, decided to march on regardless. As it is, this parliamentary session's been thrown into a degree of confusion that some might describe as utter chaos. We've been enlightened, though, to some degree today by a statement from the Leader of the House, Michael Foote, who this afternoon said that the government still stood by the principle of the bill and indicated that it still hoped to get it through by the end of this session. But how? That's the problem. Well, it seems Mr. Foote has borrowed a leaf from the Tory notebook, from their plan for an all-party convention. No, we won't have that, says Mr. Foote, but we will have discussions with all the other parties in the hope of achieving wider agreement which would allow the bill to go ahead. I should say that Mr. Foote's proposal was greeted with somewhat less than enthusiasm by most of the assembled MPs. However, it does mean that for the moment our politicians can cease their earnest debate about the issue in the Commons in the certain knowledge that they're wasting their time. Nonetheless, the government's attempt to snatch victory from the jaws of defeat in this way is by no means assured a success. The discussions between the parties will raise as many problems as they're intended to solve, problems which merely re-emphasise the scale of the government's present crisis. For what is now at stake is the government's credibility, its morale, and its survival. We have in the studio tonight some of those who, if they'll forgive the term, comprise the pieces of the complicated devolution jigsaw. Mr. McIntosh, as a Labour MP who supported the government in the guillotine debate, isn't it the case that the Labour government has really brought this upon itself, an ill-conceived bill brought forward too hurriedly in order to buy back, as it were, Labour votes in Scotland at the next election?
Well, to take some of your points, I don't think it was too hurriedly brought forward because this has been talked about for a long time. I don't think that it was simply to buy back Labour votes in Scotland because there was no clear evidence that it would do so. It was really to solve a problem, though I accept that the problem was really forced to the front by SNP victories. I would agree that the bill was unsatisfactory, though I had hoped that we would amend it and improve it during its passage through the House.
Do you think that Mr. Foote's proposals now for talks really will bring any chance of a consensus which will let the bill go through?
Well, I can't see this myself because he is committed to having an executive, and I understand that the Conservatives are not and would like an assembly, but keeping the executive as part of the UK executive. Then the Liberals, I think, and Jim Sillars would take the same position as I would, that any talks presumably include those of us who actually want a proper piece of devolution, and we would want proper tax-raising powers. We would want a lot of the amendments that were put through the Scottish Labour Party conference. But now, I don't see... He never gave us those in the early stages. I'm not quite sure why he should give us them now.
What can you think is in the mind, then, of the government when it's decided to take this step?
Well, my guess is that bilateral talks is an attempt to buy a little time and let itself gently off the hook. I can't see that there's any other explanation of it, because if they were not prepared to produce a better bill... You see, one of the problems of the bill is that it never had the support of the people who really wanted devolution. It was brought in by people who were not, as far as I could see, really solidly sold on the idea themselves. They hadn't thought it through or worked it out. They therefore didn't have people batting behind them who'd backed devolution over the years.
Can I just pick up your off-the-hook phrase? Do you mean to say that they'll be able to find themselves in a position where they will be able to kill off the bill? Is that what...
Well, it's not so much that. I imagine that when they've talked to the Conservatives, they will come back and say that they couldn't possibly reach agreement with them because they don't want an executive. When they've talked to the Liberals, they couldn't reach agreement with them because they won't accept proportional representation, and they won't accept the five or six other points points that David nominated.
What happens
and,
then?
What happens then is they say that there's not sufficient consensus, and I don't know, but they'll have to abandon the bill, I would guess. I can't see what other thing, what else they can do.
No, Francis Pym, you were going to say.
Yes, I was. I mean, I think what's happened in the House of Commons is that the defects of this bill have been exposed as being of such a serious character that the House of Commons really doesn't any longer believe in it. And what is so frightfully serious about it is that it's dealing with an issue of real importance to the people of the United Kingdom, but particularly in Scotland. And they have mishandled it. They said they were going to produce a dummy bill last year, and if they had done that and allowed the debates that they intended to have, then all these issues that we've been debating now could have had a preliminary run. And then when they came to the bill the next time, they could have taken on board all the criticisms that would then have been made, and they would have had a greater chance of success.
The Tory party has welcomed these talks. Do you in reality see any prospect of a consensus emerging which would allow the bill in its present form, or more or less in its present form, to go through?
It remains to be seen. Of course, the government have not picked up the proposal that I made last week. They've done it on a much more limited scale. And of course, in doing it now, I think it's a right thing to try, but how much better if it had been done at a much earlier stage when the atmosphere had not been fouled?
What's the government got to give you, as it were, to gain some support from the Tory party?
Well, that remains to be seen. But I think this bill as such is a dead bill and ought to be set onto one side, and the attempt ought to be made to reach an agreement of some kind, or at any rate the attempt made, and then the government, if it so decides, to come forward with something else.
Isn't there a sense in which these talks are really rather convenient for you, because they allow you in a sense to preserve the illusion that the Tory party is in favour of devolution while ensuring, in fact, it dies?
I have always been in favour of it. I said so at second reading. Long before that, I was saying in my party.
I'm talking about the party, the real gut of the party.
Indeed. I've always believed
in it. Deeply committed to the principle of devolution.
Indeed, we've got long credentials in this. In fact, we started looking at it before the Labour Party ever thought of it. It was Mr. Wilson, as he then was, after the SNP began to make some gains.
Why did Buchanan Smith resign and Rifkind, your two spokesmen for Scotland, resign on devolution if you were so deeply committed to the issue? They came to the conclusion that the Tory party was going straight against it.
For two reasons. They thought that our vote against the second reading would be misunderstood, and secondly, they believed it would be an advantage if this bill was debated so the details could be debated. And they have been proved right in point of fact, because by debating all the details, the real implications of this bill have come to light. And the Tory party was all together the other night, as you well know, because they all felt that that the issues were so great that really it wasn't reasonable to curtail debate.
Mr. McIntosh snatched my question from me, for which thank you. And can I ask you, Mr. Steele, for the Liberals, are you presumably too quite glad about the present situation, because it allows you, as it were, to extract even more from the government in future in return for your possible support for only devolution but other measures?
That's not quite the way I look at it. First of all, I don't share this general mood of gloom and pessimism. I happen to think that it's a very good thing that from time to time governments should be defeated in the House of Commons, particularly if governments are putting through a very bad piece of legislation, and particularly on a timetable motion, because after all, what the government was asking the House to do was to vote to stop its own possibilities of amending the bill, to limit its own possibilities by a timetable motion. And it's quite good and healthy for parliamentary
democracy. It was going to take something like 8 years, according to most judgments, to get the bill through in its present form.
That's not so at all. But I think they would
have... You mean that you would have accepted a guillotine later, or would have been happy about a guillotine later?
You could have a guillotine later. I mean, one has to go back, I'm afraid. One of the first criticisms that has to be made is they should never have introduced Scotland and Wales in one bill, and many of us said that long before they got underway. I mean, frankly, many of the inter-party discussions should have taken place before they suddenly put the bill on the floor of the House.
If we come back today, tomorrow and next week, is there any reality, any possibility, in your view, of a consensus emerging to
yes,
let
I
the
do.
Bill go through?
I do, because there was a consensus on second reading, there was a majority of 40 on second reading, and the government's behaviour since has lost many of the friends of the devolution bill. What they've got to do is regain them. I think it is still possible if their proclaimed flexibility turns out to be actual flexibility.
I know that there are a number of things to regain the Liberals that they've got to offer. Is the main one proportional representation?
No, you see, the government keeps raising proportional representation. I made a speech of 25 minutes on the guillotine debate. I mentioned proportional representation in passing in one sentence, but they keep coming back to this. We've had the debate on PR. We had a vote in the House. We lost it. I accept that as a Democrat. And indeed, there is much concern for the Liberal Party to get it into the House of Lords, get it through the Commons and into the Lords, because proportional representation will have a more objective debate there. there. So proportional representation is an issue of the past. We're now talking about the defects of the bill, the overlapping of the Assembly and the House of Commons, the excessive powers of the Secretaries of State. These are the issues which are
And you can conceive of the government offering you terms, as it were, which would engage the support of your members, your 11
or so
members.
I think you're putting it a bit too crudely, because I don't think it's a question of our terms. I think there is widespread criticism of the format of the bill. I think it is still possible to improve this bill and get back the consensus which existed at second reading.
Eric Heffer, you were one of those 29 Labour MPs who either by opposing the bill or abstaining brought about the defeat for the government. Mr. Foote's talked about bilateral discussions. Do you expect him to hold bilateral discussions with your party of dissenters, abstainers?
Well, I would have thought the success of any bill in the House of Commons depends upon the support that it gets from its own rank and file, as it were, its own backbenchers. And it's quite obvious that the government underestimated the real gut feeling that existed amongst a strong body of the members of the Labour Party who were not convinced. They felt that there hadn't been sufficient discussion. I agree with John McIntosh when he said it had been discussed in Scotland at considerable length and over many years, to a lesser extent in Wales. But the members of Parliament sitting for English seats, the only time it was discussed in any serious way was at this year's Labour Party conference, after the whole thing had been brought forward as a white paper and so on. And this was underestimated. And if you're going to get the support of your members, you must discuss it with them early on and convince them.
What have you gained, though, from humiliating the government? You now have the all-party talks. They're not much use to you, are they?
Well, I said, in fact, after I came back from the Troon conference, that we ought to have a referendum to consult the Scottish people and the Welsh people. I said there should be, in fact, a referendum in the three parts of the United Kingdom, but held separately in each country. Now, that wasn't done. So the people were not consulted in Scotland. The people were not consulted in England. Had they have been, and had the majority of the Scottish people said they wanted devolution, or even independence, and in Wales, then people like myself, who are not happy about the bill, would have said, well, OK, fair enough, that's what the people want. If that's what they want, we've got to agree with them.
In order to regain the support of the 29, are you saying that...
It's more than 29, actually.
Well,
there's a 29 majority, but the number of Labour MPs was 22 actually voted against, and something like 20 who abstained. That is a sizable number of backbenchers.
Those 42, if that's the right figure then, those 42 MPs don't all oppose for precisely the same reason. It's not clear, is it, that the granting of an instant referendum would win back the majority even of those votes.
Well, this is, I agree, an imponderable. One does not know how many of those, even with a referendum, would actually accept the referendum. I accept that.
Does that mean that do you think that the talks that the government now proposes will have no effect then?
Well, I don't see how you can get very far with talks, to be quite honest. I really can't, because, look, the Liberals want a federal structure, a federal system. I don't know what they're going to propose in their talks. The Tories, as they say, they're committed to devolution. I don't deny that for one moment, but it's much more limited than what the government are proposing. Now, the Scotnats want to go further, and so does Jim. Now, the position is, where are you going to get with that sort of talk? I don't know what you can come up with and then present to the people on the basis of those sort of talks.
It seems
to me that if the government could ensure its own support in its own ranks, then together with the Nationalists, you would actually get it
through. Don't you think a broad measure of agreement, if it can be achieved, is an advantage in a change of this kind?
Well, I'm not against it if it can be achieved.
But you think it can't be achieved?
It's unlikely.
But you would accept that there is a hard core of members in your party and in the Tory party who will never be convinced of the case for devolution.
Yes,
in my view, one should forget about them and find where is the measure of agreement in the House, which is what Michael Foote referred to today.
I think that's absolutely true.
Can I move on to Gordon Wilson, our Scottish nationalist? You, as I understand it, supported the government's guillotine motion because you thought it would bring about or hasten the day which devolution would first take place and then separation eventually for Scotland. You've now described the talks, I think I'm right, also as being meaningless nonsense, the talks that are proposed, and that you'll do what you can to bring down the government. What purpose can be served by your leader tonight, as I understand it, meeting with Mr. Callaghan?
Well, we requested the meeting with Mr. Callaghan before the government made a statement in the House this afternoon. Uh-huh. And it was to find out how the government proposed to retrieve the mess that they had made of the devolution bill. And we've given them support. I would agree with what others have said. It's not the best of bills. It requires improved, even from attitudes different from our own of wanting independence. But I'd like to make it perfectly clear that in the House, I've seen it over the last 4 6 weeks or so, that there is a substantial minority in the House of Commons which will block any, or try to block any type of move towards self-government for Scotland, regardless of what agreement is reached by the front benches, or indeed perhaps even regardless of what comes out in the referendum.
What do you gain, though, from trying to bring down the Labour government? You gain, as an alternative, possibly a Conservative government, somewhat less dedicated on the face of it to devolution and the Labour
government. No, what we would get is a majority of Scottish National Party MPs with a mandate to obtain independence for Scotland. You see, what's happening in Scotland at the present time is that we've been waiting now for 10 years for action. The government, this present government, the Tories, for instance, who had a long pedigree, as Francis Pym mentioned, in favour of some form of devolution, didn't do anything when they were in power from 1970 to 1974. They wasted their opportunity. The present government has taken 3 years to get to this extent. And meantime, people in Scotland are getting more and more impatient about the lack of government action. Now, this bill is dead.
Can I go back to my question? Let us assume, for the purposes of argument, that you're correct, that you do get more Scottish nationalist MPs at the expense, yes, at the cost of Labour Party MPs and all that that implies for the strength of a Labour government in the future, if it were to be a Labour government. How, under those terms, do you help bring about independence for Scotland constitutionally?
Well, if you get a majority of members of Parliament, of course, elected under the SNP manifesto, that is a mandate for independence.
Do you mean you seize it?
No, we have a democratic right to obtain it.
Are you saying that you would be prepared, if you don't get it through either the Labour government or a Conservative government, that you are in that kind of mood now where you will just seize it, as it were, that you will constitutionally break away like Ian Smith did in Rhodesia, that kind of thing?
No, you've got to relate this to the 1970s situation where the days of imperialism are over, and world opinion would not allow a British government to prevent the people of Scotland, who are a nation of long standing in the world, from obtaining independence when they wanted it. Because you've got to remember that Scotland was a partner in the Union. We were never conquered. We agreed to go in voluntarily, and the right of any partner in any partnership is to withdraw from that partnership if so desired.
Can I ask you one more thing then, because I think I understand the implication of that. If there were to emerge a consensus as a result of these talks, and the bill as a result, perhaps modified, were to go through, would you then abide by that bill if it were modified?
Well, it depends on the bill. For instance, if you say modified, does that mean weakened? The
yes.
present measures?
Yes, that's what I'm talking about.
Well, in that case, I think we would have to reconsider very substantially our attitude towards it, because it verges on the useless, and to weaken it and to take away the governmental structure would mean that the Scottish Assembly could not be able to do any of the things that the Scottish people want it to do. It wouldn't be able to get jobs, it wouldn't be able to deal with the educational system, it would be subject to veto from Westminster.
I must move on to the patient Jim Sillars, who, one of two MPs who broke away from the Labour Party because you believed that it was going too slowly on devolution.
No, it had reneged on its election pledge.
It had reneged on its election.
There is a difference, yeah.
Reneged on its pledge, then. Your position, I must confess, I find almost the most anomalous of all now, because you support the bill, you supported the bill, you supported the guillotine, but because your opponents vote down the bill, you then decide to remove your support from a Labour government which was trying to get that bill through. How does that serve socialism, and how does that serve devolution?
Well, there's an assumption in your question that the Labour Party in government is serving socialism at the present time. There's 180,000 people unemployed in Scotland who would tell you that's absolute rubbish. So there's no question about the Labour Party.
Do you mean
Party.
That you prefer to bring this present Labour government down, even if that meant a Tory government, because it's not being as socialist as you would like?
Yes, because, you know, there is an
you
argument.
Would.
There isn't. Yes, there is an argument. I'll give you one of the trade union arguments that's coming through in the shop floor now, that if in fact there were a Tory government elected now, the trade union movement would start doing the job it's supposed to do, and that's representing the industrial workers, instead of being conned by Callaghan and Healy and Downing Street. So it isn't necessarily catastrophic for the people I represent if Callaghan goes out and another Tory goes in his place.
As a left-wing MP, Eric Heffer, I know, will have things to say to that, but I want to
He'd
go
have
back.
To agree with me.
I want to well, I'm not sure that he would fund. Do you agree with him?
Well, I agree that the unemployment is too high and we've got to do far more about it. But to replace this government with a Tory government, which is committed to higher cuts in public expenditure, which would mean higher unemployment, I think that is absolute madness, and I think that would be the view of the majority.
But of course, Jonathan, in the Scottish scene, we're now talking about a constitutional issue and the repercussions that would follow from an early general election. There is no question about it. That both the unionist parties in Scotland would be annihilated at the next election in Scotland, and there would be a demand from the Scottish people, probably in the return of the SNP, incidentally, which Westminster would be unable to resist.
Can I just question that assumption? Because all the opinion polls show that about, I think it's 40% of the people who vote for the SNP don't in fact vote for independence. And if Gordon Wilson's tactic is played, that they make the next election an election for independence, for the mandate for independence, many of the people who vote SNP at the moment for other reasons will, I think, melt away. And I don't share this assumption that put the straight question of independence and they will get a majority.
I want to ask John McIntosh on this constitutional issue. Are we right to understand that the Scottish Nationalists, were they to emerge in the force which has been proposed there, can quite legitimately break away?
Well, I don't think anyone can legitimately break away, because that is to break a law which applies to Scotland as well as to England. But I think the SNP have got a point here, which everybody ought to recognise, that if you have governments in Westminster saying we can carry through a mandate because we got 38% of the support of the electorate, and that entitles us to carry out everything for which we stand, although we know lots of people never read the manifesto and didn't agree with this or that bit of it, we can. Now, you can't blame the SNP, which has at least talked about independence more clearly than any other party's talked about any single item in its programme. If they get 38% of support in Scotland, which would probably give them a majority of the Scottish seats, to claim some sort of mandate. I don't like the mandate theory of politics.
They've
got a debating point.
Is that day, as it were, as a result of what we've been hearing tonight, the reactions to what's happened, not actually coming close?
Of course it is, and this is why I, for one, I was anti-SNP in this reason, this is why I moved a PR amendment for proportional representation in the Assembly, because in Scottish politics today, with three parties just about equally divided before this episode, any one of them, with 2 or 3% more, could get a majority of Scottish seats. And where I think David's wrong is I agree with him that you will not get people rushing around the streets shouting for independence now. But I do think that the SNP at the moment running at 33% in the polls, I think Labour 28, Tory 29 in Scotland, that a feeling about this bill, just generally, that this government has let them down, as Jim would say on jobs, and he will say at the election, and as some you will say on prices, and then for the SNP to say, and on top of that, something which this government could have given. Nothing to do with world forces, something within its own power. They could have done this, and they promised to do it, and they haven't. This might give them the 2 or 3% extra, which would give them the majority. Now, could I just finish on this?
I want to ask you another question.
Quickly get this? What I am really worried about is that I cannot see at the moment a majority in the House of Commons for any solution
that's to
this problem.
Right,
that, I am frightened that we will get nothing till the next election, and then we will get a confrontation between a Tory, basically unionist government in London and an SNP majority in Scotland. That's the one thing I've wanted to avoid.
Can I ask you, if you're right, do we not find ourselves now in a position where either a Labour government is going to have to struggle on totally enfeebled, or an election is going to take place now really rather quickly?
No, I think this government could struggle on enfeebled for quite a while. No.
But enfeebled, not being able to bring through any major legislation.
On this point,
feeble government is a very disappointing thing. But what surely is important here is that the independence question is a separate question, which most people say very few people in Scotland really want. Isn't the point that the people of Scotland have been dissatisfied and feel dissatisfied with the government of the United Kingdom as it affects them? And to a greater or lesser extent, almost all parties have agreed that that is so, and they want to try and find a means of getting a better form of government. And that's what these talks are going to be all about.
I just want to ask David Steele, if I may. David Steele, if as a result of the situation we now have, and the Scottish Nationalists are no longer going to support the Labour government, you are going to find yourselves in a very key position.
Yeah.
Would you find yourselves happily in a position where you bring down a Labour government?
Yes, can I say this? It seems to me that within the next 2 or 3 weeks we will know whether or not the government is prepared to seek what was described this afternoon as the overall, I forget the phrase, the overall opinion of the House to get this measure through. I think it can be done. But if they don't do it, if what they really mean is they go through the sham of talking
as
to us
John
all
McIntosh
and then
suggested.
stick by their proposal
sham
without
not,
giving way, then frankly I think probably an election is the best option. Yeah.
And you would therefore find yourself in opposition and would encourage and help bring about the downfall of a Labour government?
Well, it would depend on the issue, but if there were a motion of confidence, yes, I would have thought that was the best solution. The one thing that will damage the country is to have a government that is staggering on, unable to do anything.
I just want to get that absolutely clear. In 2 or 3 weeks' time, if there has not been a serious agreement that you find yourself in support of, you will find yourselves in a position where you join the Scottish Nationalists in opposing the government, were there to be a vote of no confidence, which would in effect bring about the downfall of the government.
I don't see why you say joining the Scottish Nationalists. We are an opposition party.
Well, let me say, you would be in the lobby with them in the motion of no confidence, and that would bring about, am I right, the downfall, in fact, of the Labour government?
I would think that's quite a possible scenario, yes. Yeah.
Eric Heffer, do you feel, if that is a possible scenario, do you feel that it was worth humiliating the government on Tuesday
night?
Well,
I don't think that is a scenario, you see. I think that this has been made now into an issue of confidence when Francis Pym himself quite clearly said that the issue was a House of Commons matter in relation to this particular bill and this question. Now I can see that some people are trying to turn it to the advantage of talking about votes of confidence and so on. I think the whole problem is that we've been talking about the wrong thing for a long time. We should have been talking about the economy, we should have been talking about prices, we should have been talking about dealing with unemployment. These were the matters. And the reason why we've got into this mess is instead of dealing with those, we've not dealt with them and we've gone up a blind alley.
Well, that blind alley or not, has been devolution, about which we have no more time to talk, except to say that it's now evident, from this discussion at least, that Mr. Foote can take no comfort from his decision to talk to the other parties. That's all from this week. Tonight, good night.